Hello everyone, and welcome back to Laurence Plays Factorio Space Exploration. What is this, you may ask? Well, this is the second part of the spaceport I've been talking about in previous episodes. This is the part that's actually on my station up in orbit. And as you can see, it's starting to fill up a little bit. We've got some steel and some copper coming in here. And so far, that's about it. But as you can see, there's a lot of different landing pads here. And the idea is that each one will be responsible for picking up a different type of resource. So if we have a look here with the map view, so I can see a bit more of it. We've got coal, we've got iron, copper, steel, and then circuit types, plastic, concrete, and so on all the way up here. And then down the other side, I intend to have the more exotic things. Now, this is just a copy and paste at the moment, but this is going to have more exotic things like beryllium, vulcanite, the organic one, the electrical one that I've forgotten the names of. But you know, all those things have been going off to other planets. Oh, here's another one. Here's glass coming through now. I must have just missed a rocket landing here. That was rather bad timing. So as you can see, the way this works now. Oh, and stone as well. Although there's no warehouse of stone to be put in, unfortunately. So the way this works is we've got a system here where all of the parts of rockets are passed out of the landing pad onto this belt here, and they then get passed along here where the first 100 of them will be put into this rocket here in order to make a new rocket, which is, can then be sent off to wherever necessary. With this will also then load it up with any additional rocket pods, and also it will then stack up all of the rocket sections that are available for reuse and put them into here as stacked rocket sections. So if I switch modes, we can look in here. There's quite a lot of rocket parts in here already, and only three rocket sections. So eventually this will get filled up completely, and we can then fire it off to wherever needs it. At the moment, it's not doing anything automatically. I'll probably just drop it back down to Norvis, but I'll need to fuel it as well for that somehow. I haven't done that yet. So the idea is this is going to now be the input of all of the resources for the space station, instead of bringing them all up in one rocket and then relying on bots to do the sorting. Because I want to get away from bots, partly because I like the feel and general everything of belt-based bases a lot more than bot-based ones. And also, there's a certain amount of bot interference up here in orbit. So if you look at Norvis orbit, we've got 6.86 robot interference radiation level. I'm not quite sure exactly what that means. One is back down on Norvis, it's one, which I think means basically the robots are safe. Most of these planets seem to be 10, which means they'll be really under threat. Six is sort of obviously somewhere in between, means that there's a certain amount of threat to them. They will fall out of the sky every so often and blow up. Now I've got the research done that means that when they blow up like that, they won't damage anything. But still, it's a waste of robots, and it means that then another robot has to go out and pick up whatever they were carrying at the time when they fell out of the sky. So this has worked for a while. I mean, it was okay. We've got stuff coming in by rocket, as you can see. It's being put onto the belts. It's working. I'm not going to knock it. It does work, but it does get through a certain number of bots, and there's a certain limited throughput from these as well, as you can see by how little there is on this belt. So what I'm going to do is then have this come down here. And actually, we are still going to have limited throughput because there's only one inserter loading into here. But I've now started working with space railways. So these take normal trains, which is going to be a bit bizarre having a steam engine chucking around in space. But it does take a special type of railway for them. And so these can then... What I'm going to have here is I'm going to have a single train with two wagons on the back of it that fills up with a range of all of the different supplies that we're going to be bringing in here. And that will then go off to outposts, which will do the actual building of the science packs. And each outpost will only claim the resources it actually needs. But when the train goes out there, it'll have, say, I don't know, 10 slots or 5 slots of glass, 5 slots of copper, 5 slots of steel, and so on, just to try and get a reasonable ratio for everything. And then it'll go off, unload whatever's needed, and then come back here to be refilled. And I plan to use it in more or less the same way that I've done the outpost trains on Norvis. So as you can see here, we've got four unloaders which are unloading for through filter inserters. So we're getting out repair packs into this one, walls into this one, turrets into this one, and burner inserts into this one. And so that means I can have a single train come out here from my loading up station, which I think is, well, it loads up here with all of those things, and then it loads up over here with that. No, over here with ammunition. Yeah, so here we go. So we've got this one locomotive here, that has some repair packs. It has some should have some turrets. It doesn't seem to have very many for some reason. Oh, it's because the damaged one got in there. That's a shame. It has some burner inserts. Basically, it's got all the bits and pieces that it needs, and then a load of ammunition and some wood as well. So each time one of those stations starts to run a little bit low on any of these supplies, the train will be summoned automatically, and it will head out there and unload whatever that station needs. Simple. Well, fairly simple. And I can also do the same with fuel oil in this case for the flamethrowers. However, on back in orbit, I'm planning to set up a second and maybe even a third train with the various fluids that are going to be taken. These are going to be a little bit longer. These are four fluid wagons per train, because there's actually quite a lot of different fluids. I was originally hoping that I was going to be able to just send out warm coolant and then chill it on site and just top it up every so often as the coolant got used up. But having looked at this, there's a few more things than that are needed. Like, if we look down here where the science is actually getting done, we've got the three temperatures of coolant, four temperatures of coolant, but we've also got the orange goo, we've got lube, we've got light oil, we've got blue goo. So there's a fair amount of extra things that will need to be transported around. I plan to still have an area somewhere around here. I haven't decided exactly where to put it yet. It might go above here, maybe off to the right, maybe down here somewhere. That's going to be a bigger version of this petrochem area. That's going to be taking in loads of coal, turning it into the oils, and then keeping the oil levels balanced, making lube, making the coolant, making the orange goo and the white and the blue goo, and just loading that into the train. So. To try and concentrate as much of that liquid nonsense into one place as I can, and then I'll try and wind belts, pipes up to feed all of these tanks and keep them full of whichever liquid they're supposed to have. So, as you can see by the fact that this railway line just ends here, this is an ambitious project, and I've not got very far with it yet for various reasons. But it's coming along. I've made a bit of a start on it, and yeah, you'll just have to keep watching in the next few episodes, and you'll see me making progress. So if we look back down on Norvis again, had a bit of an unfortunateness over all the way over here in my. My spaceport. So this is now built up fairly well, and it's night of course now, so it's a bit awkward, but I've got all the trains here. They're all unloading quite nicely and loading up, and then potentially ready to load up into the rockets as well, as the rocket parts trickle through very gradually. Unfortunately, one of my rockets crashed on the way in. So here we've got a vulcanite rocket supposed to land here, unload all the vulcanite to be put into the trains to go off elsewhere and to be made into fuel, but instead of landing nicely, it decided to crash on the way in. So it did a load of damage to my spaceport, which has now been repaired, to be fair. Is the map view any better? The map view is no better. And then it's left all of these cargo pods scattered around, and these all are all holding thousands of vulcanite, which is getting very, very gradually. Well, I mean, they were full when they landed, so we're halfway there. And these are getting very gradually unloaded by my construction bots, because they're automatically marked for deconstruction, which is nice, I suppose. But that means all of my construction bots, as you can see here, are now in use, all 3,000 of them, just trying to empty these out as much as possible. And that means what I decided to do after this happened was I thought, well, if I put in a requester chest here and tell it to demand all of the vulcanite, then at least they won't have to carry it as far. But of course, because all the bots are busy doing this, they haven't built this chest. And as far as I'm aware, there's no way to prioritise things for bots in Factorio. So that's going to mean this is all of this is going to be being taken off miles away to, jeez, I don't even know. Over here, apparently, they've decided it'd be a good idea to store the vulcanite over here, which is bloody stupid. But my other thought was I could even put in some yellow chests down here, so they've got somewhere to dump it. But again, I can't do that because I'm off in space and there's nothing down here to actually do that job for me, because all the construction bots are busy doing this cleanup. So that's a bit annoying. Now, it turns out that the further a rocket goes, the more likely it is to crash. So the reason this one crashed, if I look on Ganymede, it's a long, long way from Ganymede back to Norvis. So these rockets have a landing chance of 85%. So 15% of the time, that's one in about six, one in six, one in seven of these rockets is probably going to crash like that. And that's, to be honest, that's not good enough. I'm going to need to look into more of the research to get around this. So we've got rocket survivability. ability. Yes, here we go. So this will help reduce it. So I'll add that into the queue, into the research queue, and hopefully that'll get done. But over here we've got the rockets. The problem is still rocket fuel, I think. Yes, I've massively stepped up the number of fuel refineries out here making the rocket fuel, and the number turning it into liquid rocket fuel. But I've actually run out at this point. There aren't any more of them up here. So maybe what I should do is pull the productivity modules out of these so they run a bit faster. They won't produce quite as much per input, but as you can see, the input isn't really a problem. So let's do that now if I can work out how. I think I use this, and then I say I want fuel refineries to not have anything in. And then I can grab that, I can put it across, say those, let's put it across just five of them. There we go, I think. Yes, bots come in, they've taken those away. So now these ones should go run, instead of running at minus 0.4 speed, minus 60%, these now run at 1 speed, so they're more than twice as fast. 2.5 times as fast, in fact, although they lose the extra 24% productivity. So they'll rip through this fuel a bit more quickly, so I'll need to keep an eye on it and make sure it's okay. But we will actually start to load these rockets up a bit more quickly. This one's up at 60% already, that's not too bad. This one's full, but is set to go... Interesting, I don't know why that one hasn't launched. The other problem I noticed up here on Ganymede, apart from the fact it always seems to be dark when I'm trying to talk about it, is that the nuclear power plant over here isn't capable of keeping up with the amount of electricity needed by this facility. It's okay at the moment, actually. That makes a change. But in the past, we've had points where, it's, as you can see, it's peaked there, and the steam turbines just aren't producing enough power for all of the machines I've got here. And that's probably because I'm using so many productivity modules up here that it's using an enormous amount of power. Okay, we're all right now because this entire area over here has shut down because it's caught up, and there's only little bits of it running. But when it's running flat out, it just can't keep up. So it's using more power than we have available. So when these rockets launch and they start to fill up with vulcanite again, and we get the full flow rate coming through here, it just can't keep up, and that's a bit of a problem. So ideally, I want to go out to Ganymede at some point, put in more of these fuel refineries, just so I can get even more liquid fuel being produced and fuel these rockets up a bit more quickly. And also sort out the power supply problems up here. Another thing I've done down here is I've set up this facility here, which is, this is taking in the stone that's produced by the vulcanite production, and crushing it into sand and then smelting it into glass with vulcanite, because, you know, there's loads of it up here, I might as well. And so that's producing a reasonable amount of glass. And this is where the glass and the stone on the space station came from. I'm hoping that this facility will produce enough for that to keep it running. We'll have to find out once things actually get working properly. At the moment, I have no idea. I partly put this in here as something to do with the stone that isn't just turning it into landfill, because I don't want this to fill up. So gradually, this will work. We'll get these rockets filled up with, well, not this one, but eventually these will get filled up with rocket fuel and with stone, and we'll be able to launch them off the space station along with the vulcanite. So you can see why I'm getting through quite so much fuel up here. It's because I'm trying to load four rockets, one for Norvis, one and three for the space station with the three different products. There's a lot of rocket parts up here as well. I'm going to be getting through those at a reasonable rate. As you can see here, we've got 1, 2, 3 of these containers are absolutely full of them. There's one down here that's full of the unpacked ones. This is a bit of a silly system. It's turning the unpacked ones into packed ones to try and put them into this chest, to then put them back onto this belt to be unpacked down here. But it sort of seemed to make sense at the time, because they take up so much space, I wanted to pack them as much as I could. So I could fly another, once the rocket in the space station is completely full, I could fly that over here with myself and bring a load of stuff over in order to build up some more of these fuel refineries and bring over some more nuclear power stuff as well, just in order to get this up and running at a slightly better level. But that's, I have to admit, that is relatively low on my priority list, because this is basically working. Okay, so what's next? Glass, spaceport, fuel refineries. I did fix the Kovarex system up here. I was talking about this in great length in the previous videos, and there have been a few things that I've got wrong here and there. And I think I've now probably, maybe, hopefully sorted it. The main thing I've done here, as you can see, is I've put all of the all of it onto a single belt. So we've got the 238 on one side and the 235 on the other. And this means you've got a bit more space to use as sort of buffers and things and to try and sort it out. Although now that I look at it again, I haven't fixed it. This isn't going to work. This is an endless problem to come up with the Kovarex unit system that will just keep working. And this is great for the 238. It will use the 238 that's coming around here by priority. It'll just keep passing it round and round here. And then whenever there's a shortage of it, it'll pull it in from this one. But any time there's any coming up here, like this one, it'll prioritise this side, it'll put it on here, and it'll come, yeah, so that's okay. The problem is that now I've just noticed that any 235 that's produced here, yeah, sure, it'll get down here, it'll be spat out on this one onto the other side of the belt, but then when it gets to here, there's nowhere for it to go. It's just going to back up and up and up and up and up until eventually this stops working, because I'm always prioritising the 235 from this belt, this input, and there's always going to be plenty there because the Kovarex system is working well. So what I need to do here is break off somehow. There's a couple of choices. I can either bring this 235 out from here and feed it in somewhere that's going to be prioritized higher, maybe in the bottom here, so it comes up here and is, yeah, sorted by priority. Or maybe just bring it in and prioritize it on this one. So I think I'm gonna have to have a bit of a think. But actually, no, let's sort this out while I'm looking at it. So what I think is gonna be the best way to do this. Not like that. It's gonna be bring this all the way around here. Which side is this gonna be on? It's gonna be on the bottom side, the inside. Yeah, so that's the correct side. That's where I want it. Bring it over here. Like that. So we've got a sort of an overspill. So any 235 that comes out of here, which is it's a very small amount. It's like it's 0.7% of the stuff that comes out is going to be 235, but it does come out and it will eventually block the thing up. So now it'll come get down to here eventually as the 238 gets used up. That's fine. Get sorted out. It'll come down here. It'll be on the inside. Around here, it'll come up and it'll join onto the back of this queue and therefore be prioritised over anything that's coming out of these machines, and it will eventually, yeah. I'm happy with that. That should work, I think. Once again, as I was saying in the previous episode, I took what was quite a simple and reasonably elegant-looking Kovarex setup that was fantastic in every way, except that it didn't work. I then cobbled on bit after bit after bit, making it bigger and more complicated, more of a mess, until I eventually thought, this is ridiculous, I need to redesign it. So I redesigned it to be like this, which is still reasonably elegant, reasonably simple, but again, it didn't work. So, you know, there's no point in it being elegant if it doesn't work. So now I've put in this overflow here, which makes it a bit less elegant and a bit less tidy, but it means I believe it should work. Well, we'll find out, but I think it should. And so now it's... reasonably happy with it. I think it should be all right. And there's a lot of 235 in this system down here, so even if it doesn't, well, actually it's the 238 that would run out, isn't it? It'll probably work. I think it's okay now, but I did say that the last two or three times, so I don't really want to go on record for saying that. Okay, that's tidied up a bit. So that's, I think, is everything I've been up to. I have to admit, I've been concentrating a little bit on a few other things, some of the DIY videos and whatnot. So I've fallen a little bit behind in actually playing this game, but I've got enough of a backlog that it hasn't actually been a problem yet. But I think that's pretty much what I've done. I've been putting a lot of thought into this system here in the spaceport and how I'm going to get all of this together. And not only have I been putting a lot of thought into it, I've been putting a lot of sort of bashing my head against a brick wall into it, trying to get everything into the right place so I can build it up without making any mistakes that are going to mean I'm going to have to come back and redo enormous chunks of it. I had a few ideas that I was considering for this that I sort of considered and then changed my mind about. The big one was that I was planning to put this in Kalidas orbit, which is the sun that Norvis and everything else orbits, well, nearly everything else orbits around. And the reason I was planning to do that is because, as you can see here, there's a 15,000% solar effectiveness up here, out over there, because you're really close to the sun. Now, Norvis orbit is almost 500, so it's going to mean 3 times the amount of power from each solar panel, or 15 times the power of a solar panel compared to Norvis. So I'd be able to get enormous amounts of power from a relatively small solar outpost. And yeah, I mean, I think that's probably is a quite a good idea. The only thing is that Delta V, you require 4,000 Delta V to get there, compared to Norvis orbit. Norvis is 100 delta V. I'm gonna guess it's the same the other way. I'm not really sure, but that's basically 50 times the fuel. I was worried that was going to get me onto the same sort of levels and problems I'm having with Ganymede. Which, okay, that's 57,000. That's 10 times worse, but it's a significantly amount more fuel. I'd have to use rockets to get back as well as getting up here. So there's a lot of extra things to worry about, and I decided that it probably wasn't worth it. Especially as I finally, after a million comments in the comments, just to show I do listen to you guys, I finally started building the tier 2 and tier 3 solar panels that you can only make in orbit. And these require normal solar panels plus the mirror pieces that I'm making for the telescopes up here. And I'm not making those at the moment because something's run out. Let's find out what. Because I've run out of steel. Interesting. I kind of don't care because I'm trying to move away from this building system over here, this whole sort of thing. But I don't know why I've run out of steel. We'll have a look at that at some point. But yeah, so making those, you can use that to make the level 2 solar panels, which is these things, the blue ones, the flat solar panels. And then you can make the flat solar panel 2s by combining that with holmium plates and holmium cables and some more mirrors, and those are even better. So these ones, if we look at the solar panel options I have available, I was using the generic ones. Those produce up to 60 kilowatts on Norvis, so it'd be what, 5 times that here, 50 times that in Kalidas orbit. These ones produce 400, so they're like 8 times better than the normal ones. And so 400 up here in orbit, those are going to be producing two megawatts, I think. And then these ones are another step. They're only twice as good. But again, that's a fairly big jump for only another mirror and a bit of holmium, which I have a load of anyway. So yes, my apologies to everyone who's been saying, hey, you should use real solar panels. Hey, you should use the good solar panels. Use the good solar panels. Goodness sake, why aren't you using the good solar panels yet? I now finally am. And I'm gradually upgrading over here to get to the good ones. I've still got a big area of the original cheap ones, but I am getting there gradually. And as you can see, they are hugely more effective. Here we've got the original solar panels, even though there's a much bigger area of them, is providing 51 megawatts. The small smattering of the blue ones here are producing, 20-something megawatts. And then the red ones, and there aren't even that many red ones, are producing like an almost 100 megawatts. So that makes a huge difference. And they're only running at half power output. So, yeah, as you can see there, this is potentially capable of producing 7.5 megawatts just from one solar panel, whereas these are half a megawatt. So that's a pretty big upgrade. And that's why my base is now no longer short of power. As you can see, I'm running at less than half of what's available. So that's a big improvement. And I think I'm going to need it, because for the future science, I'm going to be expanding all of this quite significantly. Not only am I going to be making the tier 1 sciences, as I'm doing here, I'm going to be trying to make the tier 2, and hopefully I'll even be able to use this to make the tier 3s. So I'll eventually end up with the spaceport here dropping off all of the resources I need. And then the trains, I'll set up. Perhaps, I don't know exactly how I'm going to do this, there'll be something over here perhaps doing astronomic science, something up here doing materials, something down here doing energy, something over here doing biological, and then I'll have some sort of central system that takes in all of the, basically does the same as this belt system up here. It'll take in all of the cubes, the what are these things called? I can't remember the various different science cubes, and then it'll make the it'll make the science cylinders of the various different tiers. It'll make the significant data of the in the various different ways that you can, and then make all the science packs, and then just feed them into some science machines. And we'll probably have another rocket landing pad, one of these things, that will collect all of the science packs that are being brought up at the moment to here. So there's a lot to do. It's going to be a long time until I get all of this working, but it'll give me a lot to talk about and a lot of things to work on. So those are my plans for the future. I'm also going to need to work on, of course, getting all of the exotic materials in here as well. So there's a lot to do, but I hope I'll get there in the not too distant future. So as always, thank you for watching. I feel like I've done quite a lot. I've done a lot of thinking, maybe more so than building, but there's a lot done, but there's a lot to do still as well. Let me know what you think, and I hope to see you next time. Thanks for watching.